we don't really even understand our own bodies well enough to kind of accommodate for what's supposed to happen regarding regarding the development of, say, our mouths or our jaws.
See, this is really interesting because, in fact, this is one of those few cases where we can actually take a lesson from paleoanthropology, and it can help us in managing today's issues and problems. See, some dentists and orthodontists are starting to realize that the best way to treat these problems with occlusion, these orthodontic issues, is not to yank your teeth out, but to stretch your jaw.
Mm.
Okay? They're putting spacers in the jaw to grow the jaw longer to accommodate the teeth, which is sort of much closer to what our bodies evolved for.
Mm-hmm.
So this is one of those cases where an evolutionary approach actually can probably benefit us in terms of treatment protocols.
Right. You know, it makes me think about the Western diet. So you described how, you know, children eat mush, right?
Mm-hmm.
The really soft foods, which, you know, it seems almost intuitive that you would do that. If you had a child and you're raising a baby, you're like, I don't want to give that child anything it can't handle, right? So, you know, what do these hunter-gatherers do regarding child-rearing and how they feed their children that is so different from how we would approach that?
Good question. In fact, I like to tell this story. I've got two daughters, and when they were younger, my wife would cut their meat into tiny little pieces, and I'd say to her, "Stop it! What are you doing?
Yeah.
Don't cut their food so much." And she would always reply to me, "You know what? I would rather pay for braces when they become teenagers than have them choke and die
right.
when they're little kids." And you know, I can understand that. And as you might expect, I lost that argument. But
yeah.
Nevertheless, you know, and I would not advocate to your listeners that they necessarily, you know, feed their kids food that's gonna to lead the kids to choke, but an occasional let them chew on some beef jerky would probably be okay.
Yeah.
Our sort of the Hadza typically feed their kids at that age. The kids are eating, you know, at we're looking at probably between about ages 6 and 12, or probably 6 to 18. Your first molar comes in at 6, your second molar comes in at 12, your third molar comes in at 18. So sort of, it's during that period of time, particularly I would guess the age 12 to 18, when that third molar is developing and not yet in the jaw, that it's critical, and kids aren't going to choke at that age. So
right.
What we ought to do is we ought to be eating foods that challenge the jaw a little bit more. And we see that whenever you're in all the cultures that don't eat processed and refined foods. There's a researcher named Rob Corcini from Southern Illinois who did a wonderful study of the Pima Native American group. And he looked at parents and kids. The kids grew up after a food processing facility was built on the reservation. And the kids' teeth were completely messed up. The parents, who didn't have that diet but still had agricultural products, well, their teeth were just fine. They were in line. The kids had teeth that looked just like yours or mine, which really gives us two important lessons. The first lesson is it's not genetic, because if it was genetic, the kids would have the same, or the parents would have the same messed up teeth as the kids, or the kids would actually have the same teeth as the parents.
Right.
But it is environmental, because the change was in the texture of the foods.